Welcome to Hustle and Flow with Heather Hubbard, episode number 77. Hi, I'm Heather Hubbard, and I was a litigator partner and practice group leader at an Am Law 200 firm. I know what it takes to rise to the top. I also know all too well the toll it can take on your personal life. So how do you shine bright without burning out? How do you embrace your ambition without selling your soul? You're listening to the Hustle and Flow podcast. Welcome back. I am your host, Heather Hubbard, and I have a treat for you today. I am super, super excited about our guest. I have Nicole Abboud from Abboud Media. She is a former lawyer. She is a podcaster. I'm sure you've heard of some of them. We'll go through them in a minute. And she is a speaker as well as the founder of Abboud Media. And that basically means she's doing podcasting, marketing, social media specifically, as well as video support for attorneys. So she has gone from legal to helping others in the legal space. And I have to add that she's also very, very generous in spirit. She is someone I look up to. And so I am super excited to introduce you, if you don't already know her, Nicole, welcome to the podcast.
Hi, Heather. Oh my gosh, I'm really blushing over here. And hi to your listeners. I'm so glad you guys are joining us today.
Yeah. Okay, so let's jump straight in. A lot of my listeners are always wondering how people move from law to outside of law. So tell us your story about why you went to law school, how you ended up as a lawyer, and then as a former lawyer.
Sure. So to quickly answer that question, not very smoothly. That is how you transition out of the law. So to make kind of a long story somewhat short, I actually grew up wanting to be a lawyer, right? I exhibited all the typical signs of someone who should be a lawyer, and everyone told me I should become one. And I really deep down wanted to be a lawyer. So I became a lawyer. And when I started practicing, I realized fairly quickly that I think maybe I made a mistake. I don't know if this is for me. I don't see myself doing this for the rest of my life. And a little part of it was maybe just being a new lawyer and getting a feel for the profession. But there was something deep down that kept nagging at me that just wouldn't go away, even though I kept practicing year after year for a total of about 5 years. So during those 5 years, I launched a podcast, which I'm sure we'll talk about a little bit later, called The Gen Y Lawyer. And through conversations with other lawyers who were doing amazing things with their degrees, whether in the profession or outside, that gave me the courage to finally leave after 5 years. I made the decision to just quit. I told myself January 2017, I'm launching this business. I'm making it official. So I launched my Abboud Media business, which is marketing. It's legal marketing for lawyers, law firms using videos, podcasting, and social media, like you mentioned. And that's what it's been for the past 2 years. So, and like I said, that's a long story, somewhat short, but kind of throughout those 5 years, there was a lot of inner like turmoil and just self-exploration and figuring out what else I could be doing with my life. And also just dealing with the whole part of me that thought, you know what, I made such a huge mistake, a six-figure mistake. I'm going to law school. And then the next day waking up and thinking, no, this was not a mistake. This is going to serve me well. So a lot of self-exploration was going on.
Yeah. So I hear this from so many people. They're like, I shouldn't even be a lawyer. You know, I question this. What was it for you that finally, you know, I mean, I know you said you had started the podcast while you were still practicing, mm-hmm. but what was it that finally made you decide to just take that leap, to just start your own company and to say, you know what, I'm going to leave this lawyer hat behind? Because some people really struggle with, you know, I did a little bit as well, with walking, and you may not have, with walking away from the lawyer identity.
Mm-hmm. No, I struggled with that. And I think that's probably common for a lot of lawyers who are debating if they want to leave or just recently left, because it becomes such a big part of us. And honestly, there's a huge ego part of it. Like, we love saying we're lawyers. It gives us a little bit of an ego boost, right? Because it's an honorable profession. So for me, I honestly, what worked for me was giving myself a deadline, kind of, not time-wise, but more of once I get a certain amount of clients unofficially, kind of on the down low, before I officially announce my business, when I get enough interest. And for me, that was only two clients, a very low bar. I told myself when I have two and it's making some money, I'm just going to commit to this and put it out there and take my last legal client and start taking more marketing clients. So it was kind of based on how, like, can I actually get clients? Can I make this work?
Yeah. How did you even get into, right? Because, like, you know, I'm still doing kind of an extension, you know, and you are working with lawyers, but video and social media, you know, a lot of, like, that just doesn't, that's not secondhand nature.
Yeah.
Do you have, like, prior experience or just a passion? Where did that come from?
Yeah, that's, you're right. It came out of nowhere. That is not my background at all. I'm a political science major. That was, wow. I mean, that's kind of, yeah, it's kind of the typical route that most wannabe lawyers take. But when I was practicing, I actually started off working for a firm, a very small firm. And luckily my employer was very, he let me kind of play around with some marketing ideas and pitch ideas to him. And some he adopted, some he didn't. And it was just based, these ideas that I was coming up with, I don't even know where they came from. They were just based on my maybe understanding of how people want to hire lawyers or what they looked for when they were searching for lawyers. It just came out of nowhere. So I started practicing when I was still at that firm or practicing the marketing side of things.
Yeah.
But I think a part of it is just, it comes down to understanding human attention, relationships. Not, I mean, it doesn't matter what the format is. It turned out to be videos and podcasting, but at the core, it's really conversations that are happening. It's really raising awareness of what lawyers are about, what they stand for, what their message is. And so, yeah, it just grew from self-interest. And then it became more of, I actually learned about it. Like, I started taking classes. I started doing self-studying, reading books and becoming really good at it. And of course, practicing it. So just putting everything that I learned into practice and learning more about it.
You are like my poster child. I love this because so many attorneys say, you're like, I've got a degree. I can only do this. And I'm like, you can do whatever you want. If you were smart enough to get a law degree and, you know, that requires like a lot of persistence.
Yeah.
You can do anything. You can do whatever you want. When I started my company, I mean, I'm scrappy. So like I would watch YouTube videos on how to code, right? Like I don't highly recommend that you do that, but initially sometimes you got to figure it out. So it's like, yeah, you can do anything. So I love that you just embrace that. And we're like, I'm going to learn this.
Yeah. And I'd like to think, and maybe because we are lawyers and I hold us in high regards, I really do think lawyers can do anything. Like we can learn anything. And you're right, because we gain certain skills in law school, mostly the ability to study for long periods of time and retain information and do research, we can apply that to anything. So I don't think that's the real reason that lawyers don't leave the law. It's not so much that they're like, oh, I don't know what else to do, because anything, pick anything, you can do it.
Yeah.
It's more of, what else is really gonna make us the same amount of money? For me, it's always been, or my experience with other lawyers, it's always been what's gonna make me happy, but also kind of bring in the same amount of income, which is hard to match sometimes because lawyers, well, some lawyers make a lot of money.
Yeah.
So that's usually what it is.
Yeah. Okay. So let's talk about when you were at your firm, you said you started, that's when you started. And I don't think we've actually said the name. It's the Gen Y Lawyer. Mm-hmm. And I assume that every single listener here has at least heard of that podcast.
I hope so.
If you've not listened to like every single episode, I mean, your podcast is really the first legal podcast that I remember. I mean, when I read that you started that in 2015, I was like, that had to have been sooner. I mean, later. Because I feel like it has been around for like a really, really long time. I mean, you were like, in my mind, you were like a true trailblazer.
Oh my gosh.
Started that. I mean, there really weren't any, in my opinion, I mean, maybe I'm wrong. There really weren't many legal podcasts. And I hope this doesn't sound wrong. They weren't the best. Like, I don't know.
Yours was I know where you're going with this one. You're right. They were very fun. That's what it is.
Yes. Thank you.
So thank you for all that. Yeah. So there definitely were legal podcasts way before my time. But there weren't, from my research, any that were tailored to young lawyers. So in that regard, it was one of the first ones. But podcasting in general,
super serious, right?
That too. There weren't, so I kind of wanted to, that was one thing that I thought I can bring to a podcast is a little bit more personality. And granted, it wasn't going to be about the law per se. So it wasn't about legal practice area. It was about the people practicing. I knew that I could make this more fun, more conversational. But in general, podcasting kind of started to blow up, so to speak, in 2015. And most people credit it back to Serial. If anyone has heard that podcast, it's pretty great. Yeah. But so that's probably why. That's probably why it seemed like it was kind of there earlier. But yeah, so I believe the question was, how did it get started or why you decided to do that?
Yeah.
So I started off with blogging. I had a legal blog because I thought I really want to do content marketing to bring attention to my practice. And at that point I had launched my own law firm and I didn't have any money because I was a young lawyer and a new law firm owner. So I had to figure out a way to bring attention to myself without spending any money. And I had time at that point. So I started blogging and I realized that I didn't really enjoy writing that much because I would write all day and then I didn't want to, that's the last thing I wanted to do when I got back home. So I started exploring podcasts. It kind of appeared as an icon on my phone and I'm like, hey, what's this purple button on my iPhone? And started listening to podcasts and quickly fell in love with it because it was so easy to consume it. And then I thought, you know what? I'm fairly good at talking. I think I have a pretty good personality. Let me see if I can put it together and create my own show. And then of course I thought of what topic it would be. And I thought for me, what I really want to learn, the questions I had were for other lawyers. What were they doing to build successful careers, to find happiness in the law? So I focused it on millennial lawyers and started reaching out and recording conversations that I had.
Yeah. And they're great. I mean, guys, if you haven't listened to it, I'm technically not a millennial, but I still really enjoyed the podcast episode. So I encourage you to go listen to them. But you've recently, the Gen Y lawyer still exists, but you have a new host because you started a new podcast called Leaders Love Company. So what was the thought process behind, one, moving from one podcast to another, but two, as opposed to just stopping the podcast, having a new host come in and give it new life?
Mm-hmm. So I'd like to say that podcasts are kind of like tattoos. They're a little bit addictive. When you start one, you kind of want to start another one. You have all these ideas. But no, for me, I hosted the Gen Y for about 3 years. And I mean, a lot changed in my life over those 3 years. First of all, when I started it, I was a lawyer. And then when I stopped hosting it, I wasn't a lawyer anymore. So I kind of transitioned in my own life from law to business. But I learned a lot from my guests, about myself, from the information, the conversations we were having. And when I thought about what else I wanted to do, what else I wanted to speak about, and what else I wanted to build my platform on, because I had built my platform, my brand on this podcast, and I wanted to kind of transition to another topic, I thought about leadership. But then I thought, you know what should I do with this great asset that I have that served me so well, that helped me build a speaking career, that helped me build my business? And I didn't feel like I wanted to let it go just yet, but I knew that I didn't necessarily want to continue hosting it just because it kind of served its purpose, right? It did so much for me, my career. I was really hoping it could do that for someone else. So I decided to stay on as the producer, but bring in a new host, someone who was still practicing, someone who had their foot more in the legal profession than I did, and someone who can breathe new life into it. So I reached out to a listener that I had been in touch with pretty often. I knew she was a big fan of the show and really loved it. And her name is Karima Gulick. And she agreed to host it. And she's kind of just taken it on, made it her own thing. And hopefully it's serving her the way it served me.
I love it.
Yeah.
You know, and that I was saying earlier, you know, that you are super generous. From my perspective, which your Facebook group has kind of changed, but it started as a Facebook group for podcasters, for female attorney podcasters. And, you know, that was just, you know, there can always be a marketing aspect to it, but you can just so feel how genuine you are and how you truly want to help people and bring people together. And so I had a lot of fun being a member in that group, which has now evolved to, I guess, having more of a focus on just marketing in general. But to me, like you really give back. And, this is part of like your speaking and other stuff, but it's really about this like human-centric way to go about practicing law and to go about business.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd love for you to like talk a little bit about the Facebook group, but also just to talk about, you know, kind of your view on business and how we can use marketing and social media to really build those human connections.
Yes. So first of all, thank you for all of that. I It's interesting. So the reason I started that Facebook group, so now it's called S-Corey, totally made up word, which I'm not sure if that's working in my favor or not, but I feel like all the trademark lawyers out there are probably like, yes, good job on that one. But I started it really, it's probably not the best reason to start a group, but it was out of frustration because I had just gotten about 2 emails from 2 male listeners of my podcast, which, I mean, I'm glad they reached out in general. I'm glad they're listening, but they reached out with some feedback, right? What they consider to be positive feedback, but it was really criticism of my voice, of the way I interview, of the way I ask questions, how long I pause. It was crazy that these men took the time to actually send this email to me. I kind of took a step back and I'm like, oh my gosh, this is what women deal with pretty often. We get criticized for our voice, both literally and figuratively. So what we're saying and how we say it. So I thought, you know what, let's create this safe space where we can share our voices, talk about our shows. And like you said, to start off just focusing on podcasts, but I wanted to expand it because I just figured we could also include video and other types of content marketing or just marketing in general, because women lawyers have a lot of questions about these topics. So I thought, let's create a safe space to ask each other these questions and have these conversations.
I love that, because I will say I totally can relate to what you're talking about.
I'm sure.
Like, the women never do that. It's only the men. And they always say it from a nice place, but it's super critical. But I feel like a lot of, especially in the legal industry, a lot of the information that's out there on how to even approach social media and podcasting and video, it's just super masculine and corporate. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I really like your down-to-earth approach, because I think it's just more authentic. In my opinion, that converts far better than, you know, the stuffy model.
Yeah, I think so too. And actually, interestingly, I feel the same way about just leadership, but also, well, leadership within a business setting. So I think that, so you mentioned these kind of masculine traits, and I also struggle to figure out what's masculine, what's feminine, but a lot of these quote unquote feminine traits are showing up as being more effective in leadership and when you're leading a business, when you're growing a business. And it translates into social media and content marketing. So just being more open, more communicative, more collaborative, these traits that are seen as, again, quote unquote, feminine traits are what people want to see on social media. They're what people want to see in their leaders. So yes, I'm a fan of this change that's happening in business and the way that people lead.
Yeah. Before we get off of the Facebook group, can you, so spell it so that I'm a member, but I still can't spell it.
No, it's tough. Oh man, that's a tough one. Join. So it's ESQ and then ORY. So it's a combination of Esquire and Story. So it's kind of just a play on how we tell our stories as lawyers through video, podcasting, and social media.
Love it. Love it. Love
yes.
it. I'm in the group. So come hang with Nicole and me on that. All right. So what for attorneys out there, I mean, I often think that when we think about podcasting, social media, video, we think of it as, well, that's just for solo attorneys or small mm-hmm. firm attorneys. And I totally disagree. So I'm just curious as to where you think it's most effective and how attorneys, you know, whether they're on their own solo or, you know, within a large law firm or even in a corporation, you know, how they can kind of use these channels to build those relationships.
Yeah. So I've never worked at a big law firm. So I'll be honest, I'm not speaking from experience. I'm just speaking from the stories I've heard from those who do work. But I don't think the name of the firm is as powerful as it used to be. I really do believe that now potential clients are connecting with individual lawyers. So whether they work for themselves at a small firm, a large firm. So whether you work for a big law firm or you're on your own, you need to be socializing on social media, and you need to be creating content to start building your brand. Again, whether it's for your own firm or for your overall firm. So for your brand within a firm, within a larger firm. So the way I like to see any of these channels that we have, any of these platforms that we have available to us, which, by the way, it's amazing that we live in a time when we have access to all these things like videos and Facebook and Instagram and stories, like anything that we have access to. It's pretty phenomenal. We need to take advantage of it. So the way I like to see it is really just a way of talking to people. It's really just having conversations. And I like to incorporate that into the type of marketing that we do, because I think a lot of lawyers, a lot of people have been misled to believe that marketing is just a one-way conversation where you're pushing out information and then hoping people listen and then hoping they like you enough to call you. But it's definitely a two-way street. And I try to teach lawyers that whatever it is you're doing, whatever channel you choose, so whether it's a blog because you like to write or videos because you're animated and you like being on camera, make sure that you are leading people to want to reach out and talk to you, to answer a question. You are providing information, but you're also kind of getting them to fall in love with you, which requires you to show your personality. So whatever, it's almost like you're talking to these people in person, but it's happening online. So that's kind of a quick tip.
Which can be scary, right? Because as attorneys, I mean, I don't know how you feel about this, but I feel like when we went to law school and then just the industry as a whole, like you feel like you have to show up and present yourself in this very specific, polished, almost stuffy way. And so when you start to try to engage on social media, it can sometimes be hard to just show up as yourself and not the lawyer you think you should show up as.
Yes. And that is, and I went to law school and graduated in 2011, which is fairly recent considering what I'm about to say. They were still teaching us to be very careful about what we post online, to only post professional pictures, to make sure we go to Google and scrub any bad articles about us or anything that might look disfavorable, I suppose. And that was fairly recent.
That's their,
yes,
when they're doing the like law school legal recruiting tips, they still say that. So,
So I think that is, and I get why they're saying that. Like, I get it. Obviously you don't want information out there or pictures of you doing a keg stand or just going wild on the weekend. But I imagine most lawyers have enough common sense to not have those pictures on there. So what it really comes down to is taking a step back and realizing how humans interact and what it is that they connect with others over. And it's not usually the lawyer who's wearing a suit who's showing up on camera. That's not something that is very, I mean, it's not very personable. It's not breaking down any walls. It's just adding to the belief that lawyers are intimidating and not approachable. And if you're building a business, that's not going to help you because then people are not going to approach you. So think about it. Like, what is it that you connect with your friends over? It's usually what you did on the weekend, what kind of dog you have, what beach you go for runs on every Saturday. Those are the things that people want to connect with you over. So those are the things that you should be posting about, right? It's just the human side of you.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's undoing that damage that law school career offices kind of did to us.
Yeah.
So I think following lawyers who are more social, who are showing their human side on social media, if you follow them and see what they're doing, you can kind of get a better sense of how others are doing it and doing it well and not crossing any lines, right? We're not crossing any kind of attorney-client relationship boundaries that are placed upon us by the ethical rules.
Right.
Yeah.
So when we focus on it from like the human side and the relationship side, in my mind, I feel like we've actually just kind of started the first wave where I would really like to see law firms, you know, test this stuff even more. And so I'm curious as to your feedback, is to do it internally. So when you've got like these big law firms and, you know, companies, and I know they're going to like, I can hear them now because, you know, you got to do things a very certain way. Mm-hmm. But to me, it's like, if you are a leader in a law firm, or if you are a leader in your legal department and you can't see people every day because there's so many attorneys in so many different offices, why would you not have a podcast just for your internal company so that it's, you can have conversations around these things? Because I have to, I mean, and I know I'm speaking to the choir when I'm talking to you, but when people listen to my podcast and I then meet them, they feel like they know me in a way that, you know, it just builds this relationship. And I think in so many firms and companies, there's this hierarchy and it's hard to know people on a personal level. And I'm like, this may sound weird, but this is how you build relationships with a large amount of people at the exact same time. It allows leveraging. So I'm always like, why are firms not like, why don't they do certain things with like Facebook groups and other things? And you don't have to worry about confidentiality and that kind of stuff. You get all uptight, but this is how your employees and even your lawyers are already engaging. They don't necessarily want to get on some kind of intranet channel. And so I just think there's so much room for people to be like small firm and big firm to be working with people like you on not just the outward facing, but the inward.
Yeah, internally.
Have I lost my mind? What do you think?
No, not at all. No, you haven't at all. And just quickly, thanks for the shout out. But I mean, what you're describing requires a complete overhaul of how law firms are even structured. It requires a complete dismantling of the hierarchy that exists within law firms, which is way beyond what, I mean, we can start the conversation here and hopefully inspire a listener to go and protest the way their law firm is structured. But no, that's what it is. You're right. Like, and it's not just law firms. It's a lot of just organizations that have existed for a long time. They are structured in a certain way. They have processes, they have procedures, they have the red tape, and it's very hard to undo that. And especially even when it comes to communication, you're right. Internally is where they should begin, because they need to build that culture within their firms, a culture that encourages open communication and socialization and exchanging of ideas and mentorship internally before they can take it outside and present it to others and recreate it with potential clients. And like you said, it's important to start internally, to start building those relationships, because so marketing really does come down to relationships these days. That is how clients want to hire their, that's how they want to find their lawyers. They want to find them through these personal connections that they have. It used to be word of mouth, in the sense that a friend referred another friend to a lawyer that they might have used. That's still happening, but now it's online, right? So if you're not out there talking to people online, no one's ever going to spread the word about you, or fellow lawyers aren't going to know about what you do and help refer you clients as well. So it's relationship building internally, super important. Externally, even more important. And just, yeah, focusing on meeting others and talking to them, telling them what you do and how you can help.
So if an attorney doesn't really have much of a presence, or they're listening to this and they're going, oh, I'm doing this the old stodgy way, what would you recommend as their first step?
Ooh, good question. Well, first I would say it's not your fault for doing it the old stodgy way. That is kind of what we've seen up to this point, what we've been taught. So don't be hard on yourself, and it's not too late to reverse it and kind of start changing your approach. But what's the best way? So I guess I would need to know a little bit more about that person. But if I think the best way to start is to start listening online. So do some social listening, I call it. Now, if you're not ready to start creating your own content and getting your own voice out there, your ideas, your thoughts, that's okay. Start listening. So get on whatever social media platform is easiest for you. So whichever one speaks to your soul, whichever one you think your potential clients exist on. So Facebook is always a good option. LinkedIn, Twitter, Instagram, there are many. Pick a few, pick one if you're just starting off and you're not already there, and start listening. What that means is you go to certain hashtags that apply to your practice area and see what people are talking about, see what kind of questions, what kind of posts are out there. And then also look at the pictures that are being posted, maybe connect with the people. So start following certain people in that space and really just listen. So this has actually kind of become even more apparent to me. I used to hear, oh, you should do social listening. And I thought it was a research tool, which it is. You can definitely use hashtags to research what people are talking about, and then you can go create a blog about it. But I think it's become even more important now that I'm managing the social media accounts for my clients who are lawyers as well. And I'm noticing patterns on all the different platforms. I'm noticing what people are interested in. So what is it that they like? What don't they like? What do they engage with? What solicits comments? And what do they just keep skipping past? So from a marketing perspective, the social listening helps you to figure out what are they looking for, right? Because you can think you know what they want, but until you start posting, until you start talking to people, tweeting, joining groups on Facebook, you don't really know what conversations are happening. So you don't know how to join in, what you need to say to join into those conversations.
That is great advice. I love it. Thanks. Okay. So for people that are like, okay, Nicole, I just want to hire you. Like, I need some help.
Give me all your money. Just hire me right now. No, I'm kidding.
In your own words, what services do you provide and how can people reach out and get in contact with you?
Yeah. So I guess the best way to find me is probably on the website. You can also contact me through there. So it's abboudmedia.com, A-B-B-O-U-D and then M-E-D-I-A. And then the social media platform that I am the most engaged on, that I love showing kind of behind the scenes of what I'm doing now as I'm building my business, no longer practicing law, is Instagram. And on there, you can find me at Nick, so that's N-I-C _ABBOUD. And of course, I'm sure we're going to put it in the show notes, the Facebook group. I would love for the women lawyers out there to join the group and engage in these conversations that we're having about legal marketing, branding, and storytelling. And it's called Escory.
Absolutely. And so for the show notes, guys, just as a reminder, go to hustleandflowpodcast.com/77. Nicole, Heather, thank you so much for coming on the podcast. It has been a blast. I could spend hours talking about this stuff, but I really appreciate you coming on and having this conversation.
And honestly, thank you so much for having me on. And thank you to your listeners for sticking around until the end. And hopefully they found the conversation valuable.
Absolutely. All right, guys. Thanks so much. And we'll talk next week.
For show notes, downloads, and other free resources, and to keep the conversation going, head on over to hustleandflowpodcast.com. See you there.